Hello there, my RPG lovers, and welcome to another video. Pine might look like a simple action-adventure game, but it bears the simulation tag for a reason. One of the best features about this game is the whole economy system, which makes the open world of Pine feel alive. All the species on the island of Albemarle will actively gather resources in the wilds, trade between villages, fight and try to conquer other villages, upgrade and evolve, make peace, etc. You can of course play a big role in all of these activities in a couple of ways, and the game will try to teach you how to do this as you play. However, in this video I included all the things I personally consider really helpful, and I tried not to spoil anything, so let's get straight to the tips. As soon as you're done with introduction quests and you leave the cliffs, you can choose to explore the whole world if you wish. However, one big problem that you're gonna notice straight away is your tiny inventory and a lot of things to loot. That's why it's really important to try and gather 5 Ampicus orbs as soon as possible and bring them to Grub. You won't have a lot of trouble finding him because he's part of the tutorial quest, however you'll have to search for the orbs yourself. Some of these orbs are slightly hidden, but usually you won't have problems finding them. I won't tell you the exact locations in this video, however I can tell you that you can easily find at least 5 orbs without going too far away from the first village. Even when you upgrade your inventory the first time, you can easily reach that inventory limit if you pick up everything that's not nailed down. The second side mission for upgrading your inventory is to collect 25 orbs, which will certainly take you a while, so you should know what materials are more important to keep. By the way, I'll have the separate video for the locations of all the orbs. You should not be scared to drop some common materials when you need space. For example, marwood and dull rocks are really useful for a lot of stuff in crafting, like basic arrows and stiff rope, but feel free to drop them when you need some space because these materials are really common. One particular material that you're certainly going to use a lot is Alpafant leather. That's why you should always kill Alpafants whenever you see them, which is not always easy because they can run away. But if you really want to, you can catch them easily, because after a while they're just like, fuck it, I wanna die. And I feel them, man, I really do. You're gonna need this letter for basic and advanced armor pieces, and one more important item called travel kit, which basically allows you to fast travel. Speaking about materials, you should know that all species have different armor and weapon set that you can craft once you have the materials and the plan. Apart from the common materials that you'll need, all species have one special material that is usually found in the area of their capital village. For example, the croaker's main area is the soggy woodlands, and their plants require toothstone, which is easily found in this area. This works the same for all other species, they all have a main village which they originate from. So if you can't find a specific material for crafting faction related gear, just try and search in their main zone. But keep in mind that all species can lose their capital village in a raid, so don't get confused if you see some other species there. You have to be allies with the merchants in order to trade with them, otherwise you can only donate items and raise your affinity bar with that certain faction. Always keep your eye on item valuation, because these items on the left will fill that affinity bar much faster. Items on the right are usually not even worth donating or trading. However, some rare materials like slick pearls always have a decent value, and it will greatly affect your side of the scale. Like I mentioned before, all species will gather resources in the world and bring them to their village. This is the reason for the red squares, because someone already looted this. If you kill the gatherer, you can get the stuff he looted, and you can even catch them while they're looting. Speaking about these particular NPCs, you will learn that token items will be really important throughout the game. All influence ideas that you can use will require tokens to make. Different types of NPCs will drop different tokens. There are guards, gatherers, traders, and raiders. It's just important to memorize their looks when you're searching for a specific token. Gatherers have baskets on their backs, guards are easily recognizable, traders have big backpacks, and raiders carry a flag. And this goes for all species. I had the biggest problem with the trader tokens because I always found it difficult to find traders. Guards and gatherers are pretty much everywhere, but traders are sometimes pain in the ass to find. Except in the villages, but that can be tricky, especially if that faction is hostile to you. You can get the tokens by killing the NPC or by simply putting the sparkle trap, which will make them drop the item and cause fear for a couple of seconds. You can do this even with your friendly faction if you're desperate for those trader tokens, like myself in this example. Before we get to quick random tips, here is some combat stuff that you should know. The combat in Pine is simplistic but fun for the most part. All species have different attack patterns that you should learn after you fight them a couple of times. The most annoying and sometimes hard to deal with are species that use a lot of ranged attacks, especially when you fight more enemies at once. Those would be the Litters and Fexal. They will always try to move out of the melee range and snipe you with a couple of bombs or spits. One attack move that I found particularly useful when dealing with these annoying things is running and sliding attack chained with two regular attacks. This is my favorite combat move all around because the sliding attack has slightly more range than anything else and you will usually throw your enemy on the ground. It's perfect while you're avoiding ranged hits and running towards the enemy. The second really important thing in all fight situations is blocking and parrying. There are some hits that are unblockable like AoE attacks, but almost everything can be parried. A successful parry leaves an opener for a counter attack which deals increased damage. You can be a god in fights if you manage to learn this. But crowded fights can be really challenging, so using your bow effectively is also really helpful. Before you find some advanced ideas for better arrows, you should always aim at a weak spot, which is usually the head. When you hear this sound, that means you hit the weak spot. Traps and exploding barrels are also really useful, but I always forget to use them, to be honest. You should lock on to the targets, especially when fighting one or two opponents, because it's hard to miss your attacks, especially after a successful parry. However, if you don't lock on, you'll have more control over your camera, but you can easily miss some hits, which can be really annoying. As you progress, you'll have more gadgets to play around with, but let's not spoil anything. Okay, now it's time for some random quick tips. Your affinity level will play a big role when dealing with almost everything in the game, and you should quickly learn that this system is really flexible, which means you shouldn't worry that much if you're hostile with a faction. Use your slingshot for puzzles. You can find arrows in the boxes that you can break, but you're gonna craft a lot of them for sure, so there is absolutely no reason for using your bow for puzzles because you would waste a lot of arrows. On the other hand, slingshot has unlimited rocks. Pine encourages thinking for yourself, so if you're stuck on some puzzle, keep your eyes open for clues, which are usually right at your face. The difficulty of these puzzles is not insane, but not easy as well, especially in caves and vaults. If you want to attack and kill the allied NPC, you will need to lock on, then attack, in order to engage in combat, or just set any trap close to him. You can only fast travel if you're allies or at least neutral with the species of that village. There are just a few zones where you can always fast travel on the map, like Temba's Hut. Every village has 3 levels, and every new village that is taken after a raid starts with the lowest sea level. You can easily influence the growth or the downfall of any village with ideas. I encourage you to experiment with this system because it's really fun. And that would be all for this video. There are a lot more things that you will learn, but you should experience the rest of the game by yourself. I'm currently working on the review for Pine that should come out really soon, so if you're interested about my general thoughts about this game, make sure you subscribe. My channel is based mostly around RPGs, I do in-depth guides, discussions, previews and reviews. Special thanks to my patrons and YouTube exclusive members, and if you as well want to become one of them, all the links are in the description. I'll see ya in the next one.